Good morning. We're glad you're all here today to celebrate the life of Russ. And if you would right now, if you'd just stand while the family gets escorted in, I would appreciate it. Thank you. You may be seated. You know, we're here today to celebrate the life of Russ. What a testament to his life, that seeing the people that are here today. You know, I've known Russ for many years here at Hoffmantown Church. This is where I met him, here at Hoffmantown Church. And I'll tell you, the life that he had was pretty amazing. He served our country. He did community service here in Albuquerque. And he did mission work like nobody's business. And he loved the Lord. So let's, if you'll pray with me, we'll get started here. Thank you. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you have made us in your own image, giving us gifts and talents with which we to serve you. Thank you for Russ's life and all the years we shared with him. We lived him today in honor of his good we saw in him and the love we felt for him. Father, give us the strength to leave him in your care, in your knowledge of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to start off this morning. I'm going to bring up, we're going to do this. We have three speakers today that we'd like to, is going to speak about Russ's life. I'm going to bring up Steve Generic first, and then behind him will be Paul Civarolo, and then behind him will be Renee Senna, who'll be speaking for Brenda, Russ's sister, who wrote something that she said she might not make it through. So if Steve would come up.
Well, first things first. Many of you know I'm a crier. That's what I do. Many of you don't know that, but you're going to learn. So, if I get going, you guys can get going with me, and we can all have a good cry, and we can celebrate Russ. And right now, if Russ were here, he'd just be shaking his head. There goes Steve again. Russ Spiker. A leader and a servant. But more than that, Russ was a servant leader, and there's a difference. Our pastor Lamar has been teaching us out of Titus about leadership and influence, and I thought, man, I can go down that road with Russ, but I'm gonna take it just a little bit differently. If you knew Russ, you knew that he loved the Lord. Russ was simple. Russ was very strong. Russ was the quiet type. But he was not so simple if you could get him talking. You get him talking a little bit, and you knew there was a lot there behind Russ and his life experience. Russ had seen so much in his life. I was just talking a few minutes ago about, I broke it up into three pieces. He probably had three different sections of his life. The first section, the young section, the middle section of being in the Air Force, and then the last section, the last third of his life, is where I got to know him. But he had a long life, and he had seen an awful lot. Russ was simply a man that loved God. He loved the Word of God. Russ used his faith as his foundation here on earth. There was a day when God reached down to Russ and he told Russ, "Come with me." Russ grabbed on, and he went for the ride. remember that word picture, because later on, there's going to be a picture scrolling, and you'll remember that picture for the rest of your life. Russ reaching out. Russ was simply a family guy. He loved his family and he loved others. Russ was simply a husband, a father, a brother, a grandfather, and an uncle to many. He often talked about his family, how proud he was of all that you do and all that you're going to do. To me, Russ was a servant at home. I apologize, but this is who I am. He was a servant to family and friends. And most of the stories he shared, if you could get him to talk, and if you listen closely, Russ was always looking out for the little guy. The people that others many times miss, many folks forget about. Russ was rooting for all of us, including the underdog. He always had that view in any story that I got him to tell me. Russ served his country very well in the Air Force. He served in some rather amazing ways. When he told stories about his service time, he talked about the men that served under him. He was concerned about the little guy. That's a servant leader. Russ was very active in our church. He served in many areas. That's a servant leader. Russ served our community. And I won't even get them all here. The Shriners, the Masons, A Peaceful Habitation, Transition Home, Crime Stoppers, and many veterans events all over the city. That's a servant leader. When Russ served his country, he served all around the world. But when he was in retirement, he also served all around the world. One of the places that God led Russ's heart, along with Mary, was to Uganda, serving with AMG, Advancing the Ministry of the Gospel, in Uganda, sponsoring children, supporting and building Upendo Christian School, which is in the village of Sumba, supporting the Baganji School of Nursing and Midwifery. Say that many times fast. Russ and Mary were all in. They served on many trips. They saw the beginning of the ministry there of Reuben and Florence Musini, and they saw what God had done in just a few short years in Uganda. That's where I got to know Russ so much better, serving in Uganda. He went from my Uncle Russ to my brother Russ. Russ did many things when he was in Uganda. You should have seen him play with the kids, blowing bubbles, doing whatever he could to make them smile. I guess that was the clown in him. Building. We did some building, and I'll tell a story about that in a minute. Serving at churches and partaking in Uganda worship services in ways that we don't worship here. And Russ was all in. Serving in Uganda prisons. Going to a prison in Uganda is something like I've never thought I would ever experience. And Russ was all in. We would go to hospitals, if you could call them that, in Uganda. and pray with people there. That's a servant leader. A couple of stories for you. On the first trip that Russ went to Uganda, we were kind of told the ground rules. Don't take pictures of the police. Don't take pictures of the military. They don't like that. Don't take pictures of power plants, government facilities, bridges. They don't know what you're up to when you do that. We're driving in our bus. The team is on the bus. And the military chased us down and pulled us over because somebody was taking pictures of the hydroelectric dam. So the police jumped on our bus. They asked our guides what we were doing there and who we were. And our guide did a good job of putting the military off. And we're all wondering what's going on. And I look over at the bus in one seat behind me, and Russ is holding his cell phone and he's pointing at his camera with a very guilty look on his face. Yeah, Russ was taking a picture of the dam. The people waved us on off and let us go. So Russ is the security guy who shouldn't be taking pictures. Yeah, that was Russ. We mixed concrete starting to build a school, Upendo School. And we learned that building and making concrete in Uganda is different than here. They would wheel two wheelbarrows of rock and put it in a pile. They'd wheel three wheelbarrows of sand and put it on that pile of rock. They would take two bags of concrete, cement, cut it open, and put it on that pile. They would take that pile and they would move it over here, one shovel at a time. They would take that pile, one shovel at a time, and move it over here. Take that pile, one shovel at a time, and move it over here. That's how you mixed concrete. Then you took it and opened up the top and you pour water on it and you move it back and forth three more times. Now, if you knew Russ, Russ got in there with the shovel, but his head was shaking. It's like, how can we do this day after day? It was hard work. That night, Russ was determined to do better because there was the six or eight of us, there were six or eight of them, and we had about four shovels and two wheelbarrows. So Russ made sure the next morning we found a hardware store, if you can call it that, and we bought a bunch of stuff, shovels, wheelbarrows, and we took it out to the job site, and you've never seen happier men in your life that they had new tools to work with and everybody had a shovel. And Russ was just beaming. Because he wanted to help those workers. He was thinking of the little guy. In Uganda, there were several celebrations. They celebrate everything. Celebrate birthdays. They celebrate dedication of the land, dedication of buildings. And if you ever got Russ talking, he loved the one dedication that he could talk about, dedicating the light bulb. A section of property where the Baganji School of Nursing and Midwifery was to be built. They ran one power line to the center of that field, and there was one light bulb. But because Russ and his team were going, I wasn't on that trip, Russ and his team were there, they decided that's when they were going to dedicate it, not when the first shovel went in the ground, but when the power was run. And so they had a huge celebration dedicating the light bulb. And Russ loved to tell that story. One last story. Our missionary friend, Reuben, he's a joker. Well, Russ can be a joker too. And Russ would occasionally poke at him. They'd poke back and forth. They would have fun. Russ would do things he wasn't supposed to do on purpose. Well, in Uganda, they love their soccer. They call it football, but to us, it's soccer. And they're all in on their soccer. And when Russ would misbehave, Reuben would get his pretend card and say, Russ, red card. You're out of the game. Go sit down. Russ, red card. I can't tell you how many times Russ got the red card. Over and over and over again. And we'd joke about it here and there, and we continued to joke about it for years. If Ruben Mussini was here today, I believe he would give his friend one last red card and tell him, you're out of here. Don't come back. Because God gave him a gold card and said, come with me. The last red card. So people talk about finding modern day heroes. And I don't go with much of that. People talk about sports people and Hollywood people, and yeah, you know, they're out in public and they make a lot of money, but I don't think they're heroes. I think that's pretty shallow. But if you find a servant leader like Russ, there's your hero. That's my hero. A servant leader that loved God and loved others. A great example. God reached out to Russ, and Russ reached out to others. That's my hero. So look for that picture later, and you're going to remember that. In Philippians 2:3, it's a verse that just makes me think about Russ. It says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourself. No better picture of Russ than that. So I believe Russ would be real happy if you grabbed on to what God has for you. Then he would be just as happy if you reached out to someone else, you hold their hand, and you just say, come with me, let's try to make something a little better. Because that's what Russ did. Russ knew, because he knew, where he was going. And it's a much better place. So I ask you, do you know? Thank you.
Hey, good morning. My name's Paul Civarolo. I'm an attorney, but don't hold that against me because I'm retired. So, that's a sweet picture of Russ. I like that. That's pretty good. I like the beard. Anyway, you heard Steve talk about Russ and doing Uganda. I didn't go to Uganda, so I won't go there. I got some stories, though, for you. Russ, he was kind of an instant kind of guy. He was interested in serving others because he did that pretty much all his life. And I spent some time chatting with him. We have a group of guys in our Sunday school, and we go to lunch on Fridays. We have to go to different restaurants and kind of keep one step ahead. But a lot of times, Russ would talk to me while we're in the car. He had a hip replacement and couldn't drive for a while, so I had to kind of pick him up or drop him off, and a couple of doctor's appointments. And, you know, he seemed to be kind of quiet sometimes, a little gruff a little bit. But, you know, if you get him talking, he did a pretty good job talking. So he was in some Air Force for 20 years. I'm not a military person. My dad was a captain in General Patton's Army, which is a whole other story, so I understand kind of a military mindset a little bit. But one story he told me, I'll just tell you a couple of stories about Russ, was that somebody reported that they had stolen an ATM machine, not broken into the machine to steal money, but took a truck and wrapped a chain around the machine and dragged it off. If you can imagine dragging one of those things, scraping and sparking on a street, probably wouldn't be real hard to track it down, I would imagine. So That was pretty good. I like that. A couple times he said that he was stationed at Air Force Base in Minot, North Dakota. Been there in the summer, but he was there in the winter. It's close to the Canadian border, I think. And said there was so much snow that they had to tunnel where they were to the commissary to get food. Sounds like they're pretty motivated to do that. So Russ was a pretty innovative guy, did a good job on that. He served in a lot of different countries. He served his country well. You should be proud of him, and we should be proud of all our servicemen. But I'll tell you another kind of a story. He was involved in the Shriners, I think. And every once in a while, on the corner of Wyoming and Montgomery, they used to have the truck there, or the caboose, and they had the Vidalia onions. And Russ was excited about the Vidalia onions, and he would mention the Vidalia onions. It's like, well, that's cool, Russ. Some people like onions, some people don't. But Russ, you know, he kind of liked his onions. So I recall one time, one of our lunches at Sadie's, we haven't been back there for a while. I don't know why. You know, they ask you, oh, would you like garnish on your enchiladas? You know, I said, well, lettuce and tomato, but no onion. In fact, you can see the hat, right? You can give it to the guy with the hat, which is Russ, kind of joking around. Well, when the waitress came out and brought the food, she brought Russ an ice cream scoop of onions in a bowl, gave it to him. But Russ was undeterred, and I think he ate that entire sucker in that hour. It's like, man, I don't know what you're doing this afternoon, but good luck on that. So, but that was Russ. He was just a great guy. Sometimes he appeared a little gruff and everything, but if you got him talking, he had a heart of gold under that kind of rough, kind of tough exterior. But here's one story I will definitely never forget. When he was in Hawaii, he would tell me, I don't know, he maybe told everybody else, when the planes came back from Vietnam, and he spent time in Vietnam, and they brought prisoners of war to Hawaii, whether it was 2 p.m. in the afternoon or 3 a.m. in the morning, there was an honor guard on that airfield to welcome those folks back when they touched down on U.S. soil. And he told me that when those folks got off the plane, some could walk, some could be in a wheelchair, maybe some in a stretcher, some were in good shape, some were skin and bones, being prisoners in a horrible place, they would salute the American flag. And Russ was proud to be there as part of that guard and proud of those guys. So that was a pretty good story. I thought you'd like that. You know, towards the end, I don't know, if, you know, though, maybe the last few months, Russ, you know, wasn't in great shape. I mean, my gosh, he had an oxygen thing. He fell and had his wrist in a brace, hurt his rib. Good night, he was falling apart. But tell you one thing, though, he always had a positive and a great attitude. And you could say, well, you know, he was just a tough guy, Air Force, tough guy. Yeah, that's probably true. You could say, well, you know, he just had a positive outlook on life. Yeah, that's probably true. Could maybe say, just didn't want to complain. Yeah, that's probably true. But the primary reason that Russ had an incredible attitude despite his physical ailments and his limitations and problems is because he absolutely, positively knew where he was going when was all said and done. And that made the difference. He knew he was going to be united with Jesus in heaven. And knowing Russ, he'd want me to say this because otherwise I don't want to get in trouble when I get up there, tell you that. As Jesus said to his disciples, this is in John 14 for you people checking me out, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, talking to individual people. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you where I am, so that where I am you may be also. And Jesus also said in John 14, I think it's verses 1 through 6, Lamar knows that. He's a sharp guy over there. And Jesus also said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And Russ firmly, firmly believed that. And he wouldn't want me to tell you that. After I speak, I think someone else is going to come up, read something, and then they'll show some pictures or whatever. And then Mr. Jim Durholt, where's Durholt? Is he sitting down somewhere? There he is. Oh, not yet. I know you're anxious, not yet. Then Mr. Dillholt's going to kind of come up and explain a little bit more detail. But if you don't know the Lord, if you don't have a relationship, and I'm not talking about going to church, being part of a church, a membership, a religion, being better than your next door neighbor, I mean, that's all well and good. But if you don't have a relationship with the Lord Jesus, really, really need to consider that. And Russ would want me to say that, otherwise I don't want to be in trouble. Need to have a relationship, not a religion, a relationship with Jesus as Lord and Savior. He died on the cross, paid the penalty for our sins, rose again. And just a couple of things in Acts. Acts 16:31 says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. And Acts 4:12 says, for there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. So Russ would want me to just tell you that. And like I said, to the very end, he was a great guy. We will miss him. And I know a lot of you will miss him too, but you know where he is, and he wants you to be there when it's all said and done. So thank you very much.
Good morning. I have a message to Russ from one of his sister-in-laws, Claudia, which is Mary's sister. I'm terrible on the phone, but I wanted to let you know what you've meant to me and our family. And I know this isn't goodbye, but it is see you later, because I will. You may even see Pat. I guess that's the fun sister-in-law. When I got off the bus in San Antonio, scared and overwhelmed with two little girls to raise, you were there. You didn't even know me, but you cared, and I sensed that you would do whatever needed to be done just to protect us, because that's the kind of man you were. Who does that? You did. You fought for my freedom and lost so much in the process, but I sensed that you counted it an honor, even in the darkest times. You've battled your share of internal and external demons and done the bravest thing a man can do. You allowed Jesus to heal them. I've watched the changes in you over the past several years. There is no doubt that God has worked in your life to bring the beauty and strength of humility, of kindness, of compassion to the surface, alongside the protective strength you've been gifted with. Your smile and laughter is music, and you'd better get used to that tune, because soon you'll be smiling and laughing more than you could ever imagine when you hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Say hi to Mom and Tim and Claire for us. Thank you for all you've done for Mary, Aaron, Ian, Claire, and our entire family. See you later, Russ. And I have a Bible verse I'd like to read, because I think it stands out in Russ's life. And it is Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy. And I saw that in Russ and the way he loved Mary. Thank you.
I am a child of God, and he has sent me here, has given me an earthly home with parents kind and dear. Lead me, guide me, walk beside me, help me find the way. Teach me all that I must do to live with him someday. child of God, and so my needs are great. Help me to understand His word before it grows too late. Lead me, guide me, walk beside me, help me find the way. Teach me all that I must do to live with Him someday. I am a child of God. Rich blessings are in store if I but learn to do His will. I'll live with Him once more. Lead me, guide me, walk beside me, help me find the way. Teach me all that I must do to live with Him someday.
Oh!
sweet to hold. Our newborn baby, and feel the pride and the joy that he gives. Oh, but greater still, the calm assurance we can face uncertain days because he lives.
And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
And then one day I'll cross that river. I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know he reigns.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to that home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. To that land where joy will never end, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. In the morning, when die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
What an incredible life that Russ has lived and what have you. In fact, you know, today is in the life of a Marine, which is mine, I grew up as a Marine, I have done something today that I probably would have never done, and I have an Air Force tie on because of Russ here today. So my daughter had bought that for me when she was in the Air Force, and this is the very first time I have worn this tie in honor to Russ. So, but I want to talk here today about the, you know, at most funerals, you always hear Psalms 23. It's probably one of the most favorite Psalms to say or to recite. But, you know, there was once a famous entertainer who was once asked to recite the 23rd Psalms during a performance. There was a large audience that had filled an auditorium. And after he finished, everyone gave him a good applause. Well, they had asked an old man in the audience to come up and say the same psalms. After that man presented the psalms, there wasn't a dry eye in the place. Everyone was touched by his devotion to the shepherd. Well, then the entertainer came back to continue the program. And he said, and before starting, he said, you know, I know the Psalms, but he knew the shepherd. You know, Psalms 23rd is one of the most popular, probably most read Psalms of all. It brings comfort and encouragement to everybody who reads it. However, I feel that most people miss out on some of the deepest and richest truths that it shares. First, about it's in a relationship. Number one, in Psalms 23, 1 and 2, it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lay down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters." You know, David wrote this Psalms from personal experience because he too was a shepherd. Dave knew that he'd received God's lavish care all his life. The shepherd fed David in peaceful green pastures. God provided so well for him that he lacked nothing. David was satisfied. But of all this was because David knew the Lord. And he called him Lord. David knew his shepherd well, and the Lord knew David also. There was a story once told of a wealthy London businessman who searched many years for a runaway son. One afternoon, he was preparing to board a train in London when he spotted a man in ragged and dirty clothing begging for money from a passenger along the platform. His first impulse was to avoid the beggar, but there was something strangely familiar with him. When the beggar approached and asked the man if he could spare a few shillings, the businessman realized he had found his long-lost son. Crying, he said, "A few shillings? You are my son. Everything I have is yours." And unlike the businessman's son, David knew he belonged to the Lord. The good shepherd provided for all his needs. God's provisions are certainly available, but only if the Lord is your shepherd. Now, how can the Lord become your shepherd? Okay, secondly, it's about restoration. Psalms 23:3 says this, "He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." So why do we need a shepherd to restore our soul? Because it's the nature of sheep, us, to wander away from the safety of the fold. Like sheep, we have wandered into the wilderness of sin. In 1 Peter 2:25, it says, "For you were like sheep going astray, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls." Only the shepherd can restore your soul. He can make us right with God again. The restoration he gives is forgiveness of sin, peace with God. This is the reason why Jesus came to earth. So how can a sheep be restored to the fold? Through repentance and faith. The word repent means we stop going our own way and return to the shepherd. Isaiah 53:6 says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid him the iniquity of us all." Will we ask Jesus to restore our soul? We must believe that he died for our sins and that he rose again to give us new life. Will you obey the Good Shepherd? Will you repent of your sin and believe in him? You know, he can't restore us if we don't listen to his voice. John 10:11 says, "I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd gives his life for the sheep." So how can we walk in the path of righteousness? It is by Christ's death that we are saved from our sins. Paul mentioned that earlier. But it is his resurrection that enables us to walk in the paths of righteousness. In Hebrews 13:20-21, it says, "Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work you do his will, working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight to Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen." You know, the good shepherd can lead us to paths of righteousness. However, we can only do this after he restores our soul. Does this mean everybody's going to be saved by Christ's death? No, it doesn't. John 10:26-28 says, "You do not believe because you are not of my sheep. As I said to you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them. And they follow me, and I will give them eternal life. And they shall never perish, never shall anyone snatch them out of my hand." You know, Jesus offers salvation to all, but many won't believe him. Only those who believe that Jesus died for them will be saved. Has your soul been restored? Have you believed in the Good Shepherd? And third, it's about reassurance. In Psalms 23:4 says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." How can you have the assurance when you face death that Russ did? By making the journey with the shepherd. He knows the way. If you travel through the mountain passes of Tibet, you need a guide. That's all there is to it. Often the weather closes in and you can't see where you're going. But a guide can get you through because he knows the way. He has journeyed that pathway many times before. This is what the Good Shepherd has done for us. He is the only one to journey through death and come out victorious. Jesus Christ conquered sin, hell, and the grave. He knows the way. And he will personally lead you home if you are of his sheep. Mary, Ian, and Brenda, they were with Russ in the final days of his life. And they can testify of his assurance that he was not afraid of dying because God was with him. He was at peace because he knew the Good Shepherd would lead him home. Do you have this same assurance? Or does death frighten you? You won't be afraid if you know the shepherd, because he will take you home. You know, D.L. Moody said to a friend, someday you'll read in the papers that D.L. Moody of Northfield is dead. Don't you believe a word of it. At that moment, I shall be more alive than I am now. I shall have gone higher, that is all, out of this old clay tent into a house that is immortal, a body that sin cannot touch, that sin cannot taint, a body fashioned into his glorious body. I was born in the flesh in 1837. I was born in the spirit in 1856. That which is born of flesh may never die. That which is born of the spirit will live forever. Now, lastly, or fourth, it's the reward. Psalms 23, 5 and 6 says, you prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Those who belong to the Good Shepherd receive a lavish welcome when they arrive home. The table here speaks of feasting and fellowship. This will continue forever and ever. God's sheep will never again leave his house. Verse 6 summarizes this very well in the life of those who follow the Good Shepherd. Goodness and mercy follows them all their lives, and then they will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Do you have this hope? Another thing about D.L. Moody that I've read. A few hours before entering heaven, D.L. Moody caught a glimpse of the glory awaiting him. Awakening from the sleep, he said, earth recedes, heaven opens before me. If this is death, it is sweet. There is no valley here. God is calling me and I must go. His son, who was standing by his bedside, said, no, no, Father, you are dreaming. No, said Mr. Moody, I am not dreaming. I have been within the gates. I have seen the children's faces. A short time elapsed, and then, following what seemed to the family to be a death struggle, he spoke again. He said, this is my triumph. This is my coronation day. It is glorious. You know, around 4:15 on a Wednesday late afternoon, the Good Shepherd led our Russ, husband, father, grandpa, great-grandpa, brother, uncle, soldier, and friend to paradise. If you had died last Wednesday afternoon, would the Good Shepherd led you home? Perhaps you know the 23rd Psalms just like the entertainer. But do you know the shepherd? Do you have that personal relationship with him? Only those who know the Good Shepherd will enjoy the benefits of this song. Can you honestly say, the Lord is my shepherd? The promise of God's provision, sin forgiven, constant companion, and a home in heaven only applies to those who know him. Again, you may know the 23rd Psalm, but do you know the Good Shepherd? If not, will you ask Christ to be your shepherd today? Let me read the whole Psalms all at one time. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house forever of the Lord. You know, on May 6th, Monday, May 6th, several of us elders and a pastor went to go visit Russ. Russ wasn't doing so well, and Russ knew that he had a short time to be here. And we sat and visited with him for a couple hours. And I'm going to tell you, everything that's been said by Steve and Paul and Brenda is all true about Russ. One of the first things that he said when we got there, I think we woke him up, so he was a little groggy at first, but when he finally got into it, one of the first things he said was, "I just wish that more people had the assurance that I have to know where I'm going." Now let me ask you, I'm going to ask this again, do you have that assurance? We can sit here and say, oh, we know the Psalms, we know, yeah, I know Jesus and I know all that, but do we really have Jesus in our life? Have we accepted him as our Lord and Savior? I'm asking, don't leave this building today in this church without talking to somebody. If you have not, I'll be around. Pastor Lamar, Pastor Dave, there's several others in here that ask. And we can help you understand what it's like to live with Christ. It's very simple. It's as simple as an ABC. Number one is admit that you're a sinner and you can't save yourself. Two, believe that Jesus died for you and rose again. Three, confess that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. Russ would want you to do this. Russ knows where he's at. Russ is in heaven right now with Jesus, and he is in the glory that we can't even imagine. Do you want that? Yes. You know, I've heard this before, and I really have really liked it, and I'm going to share it with you. And I'm sure some of you have heard this before. It's an old Irish blessing. And the old Irish blessings goes this way. And I think Russ would really like this. May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sunshine warm upon your face. May the rains fall upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the hollow of his hand. Now, I'm going to close in prayer. And after I close in prayer, we're going to escort the family out to a reception. And then we'll finish up. I'll give some instructions. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, help us to focus on that which enables us to keep going. Remind us that time will never erase the memories and that for the moment we were not alone as we sit here together. We give thanks for the times we had with our loved ones, both the ups and downs of living life. But most of all, we're grateful for love, which is stronger than death. Help us to bear our sorrow without bitterness, to look forward slowly, one day at a time, and to gain some comfort from those who can help us ease our pain. Be with us now as we encourage and support each other. Amen. Now Susan's going to escort the family out to the reception area. You know, the family would like me to thank you for being here today. You know, this is a very trying time in the lives of every family that this happens with. And I'm going to tell you that as Mary or comes across, or any family member comes across your mind here in the next several weeks or months, make a phone call or write a card. You know, they need encouragement. I know there's some people out there that have experienced what Mary's experienced now. And it's not easy. But a cheerful phone call, thinking of you, something like that would really be beneficial for the family.